Hey guys, welcome back to Teen Muscle Radio and episode number 28. So today we are joined by Zach Poulos, or Poulos. I just asked him prior
That's
to the
it,
call.
You did it. You
I did
right.
it. Yes, good. I
Second
asked him,
one, yeah.
I asked him prior to the call as to whether I was going to pronounce his surname properly. And second time right there. So, Zach is a 22-year-old natural bodybuilder. And I've been following personally Zach for quite some time, definitely in his first competition season and more avidly his second competition season. And he has definitely motivated the hell out of me in terms of showing the potential for a natural athlete. He's obviously very, very gifted in my opinion and has an incredible physique. He also backs that up by being a coach and for Hold Your Own, which provide online training and nutrition programs. And he also preps, I believe he also preps natural bodybuilders to the stage. Is that right, Zach?
Yeah.
Awesome, cool. So yeah, I'm absolutely buzzed to have Zach on. And I think, again, like with Zach, he's a younger guy, a younger bodybuilder. He's competed as a younger bodybuilder. So it gives the viewers some great perspective into what it's like to be a young, competitive natural bodybuilder and how Zach has obviously built a pretty amazing physique, as you'll see in the picture that I'll put with the podcast. It's, you know, for 22 years old, he's got some serious muscle. So Zach, first off, thanks very much for coming on. How are you today? You all good?
Oh, I'm fantastic. Thank you for having me on. It's a pleasure.
Awesome. Cool. Glad to have you, mate. So today we're going to, like I said, primarily touch on just getting into the sport as a natural bodybuilder and how Zach has progressed. Also, we're going to touch on some of Zach's philosophies behind training and nutrition and some of the things that he's taught himself over time and how these things have changed. And yeah, we're going to have a good chat. So first of all, Zach, I'd like you to just give us a bit of a background into how you got into competitive natural bodybuilding and what was the first steps that you took in terms of training and then obviously getting involved in natural bodybuilding as a sport.
Yeah, no worries. So like probably a lot of people that you hear of, I started off playing a lot of sport when I was younger. My sport was soccer, so you call it football.
Cool.
Football, yeah?
Yeah,
football. Yeah, so I played that up until about the age of 15. And I used to play pretty competitively, so I used to play for like stateside, and I've been overseas to play when I was younger as well. So first off, when I was at the gym was probably when I was about 14 years old.
Okay.
My father pretty much just took me in, and it was predominantly just to build my leg strength.
Okay.
So I would say my first year of actual weight training was 3 times per week leg training.
Wow.
So that was about it. I didn't really do any upper body.
It's like the opposite of everyone else.
Yeah, pretty much. Opposite of everyone else. So yeah, I remember my first program. It was pretty much just like on squat, I'll do some sort of like, I'll do Jefferson squats, lunges, just like box step-ups. And I did that about 3 times per week for about a year. So all my newbie gains, I'm pretty sure, just went straight to my legs.
Yeah.
So that's kind of where I started. That was about 14. And when I was 15, I stopped playing soccer.
Okay.
You know, just whatever reasons for that. Yeah. And I probably started seriously going to the gym regularly. So after I kind of stopped playing soccer at the age of like 15, I really wasn't going to the gym regularly after that because I didn't see the need to train because I wasn't playing any sport.
Sure.
But when I was probably about 16, 17 years old, a couple of my mates from my school joined a gym and I joined with them. So basically for about 2 years before my first show, it was just going to the gym with some of my school friends. Uh-huh. And really, we didn't really know what we were doing at all. It was kind of just like rock up and pick a muscle group to train that day, uh-huh, blast that for an hour, hour and a half, and go home, really. So didn't really have any idea how to train properly. And as far as nutrition went, probably the first year, just ate whatever. But me and my mates at school were quite competitive. And I remember like one of the guys, you like kind of started to bring like tuna and rice to school with some like green beans and stuff.
Yeah.
So I was like, hey, hang on, he's trying to get one up on me. I better start eating some more protein and looking after what I'm eating.
Yeah, sure.
So from there on in, I probably just started to actually just watch what food I ate. It was more like so along the guidelines of I need to get protein in every 3 hours, very bro. And eat most of my carbs around my training. So I guess I was kind of right
Yeah,
in
sure.
what I'm doing. So after about 2 years of consistent training there, one of the guys from my gym, he was one of the trainers, that older guy, probably close to 60 years old. He asked me if I wanted to do a bodybuilding show, which I never thought about in my life before. I pretty much just lifted to look good
Yeah,
and
sure.
to impress girls, like most young guys. So I'm originally from quite a small kind of country town, rural area, but we did actually have a bodybuilding show there, which is funny enough. They don't actually run it anymore, but the show was probably 40, 50 competitors total, like male, female, across all divisions. So this older trainer from the gym, he ran that show. So basically, he just asked me to say, "Look, I'm running a show in a couple months. Did you want to, participate in it? You'll be in the teenage category. I think you would do really well, et cetera, et cetera." So just from going on from that, I kind of just told him I'll have a little bit of a think about it, because I really didn't know what bodybuilding was then. All I kind of knew was just stood on stage in a pair of undies, and I wasn't sure if I was going to be really comfortable doing that. Anyway, I end up, doing the show, and he helped prep me for the first show, and it was a 6 week prep, not a very good prep, but I still thank him to this day, because even though the way to get me to stage, I've learned, a lot better ways. Without him, I would have never done my first show, and possibly I would have never ended up where I am today.
Yeah,
So
no, definitely.
that's kind of the road to my first show. And I don't know, you probably don't even know, I've had actually three competitive seasons, not,
Not
I
two.
think you believe I do. Yeah. 2012, 2014, 2016. So 2012, like none of that was really posted on social media or anything. So I don't think too many people know about that one. But that was my first year of competing. I just turned 18 when I
Yeah, no,
started.
I think actually maybe somewhere I saw maybe a photo of you at 18 competing. And obviously it was a stark comparison to both 2014 and 2016 in terms of the level of muscularity and the condition. It was completely different. So obviously looking back at the 6 week prep versus probably what was, into the teens or maybe even the 20 week preps that you did for the later shows, obviously it shows in the different packages that you brought. One question that I did have for you, just sticking on like the initial phases, is obviously you're a really muscular guy for your age. When do you think that you made the majority of your progress in terms of hypertrophy and laying down, I guess, the foundations for your physique? When do you think you really sort of nailed that and you were like, wow, okay, I'm making significant progress now?
I think that was between my first season of shows in 2012. I had a off season in 2013, and then I competed at the end of 2014. Between that kind of year and a half, 2 year gap period, I think that's when I made the best gains. And I think between my 2012 to 2014 competition physique, that is where you're going to see the most drastic changes there. So I think in between that period, that would have been probably between 18 and 20. 18, 20, yeah, that's probably when I made, the most noticeable gains, where, I can compare two pictures and be like, wow, they're just two completely different people.
Yeah, for sure. What do you put that down to? What sort of changed after your first show that made that off season so good?
Cool. So I think I put it down to, I think it's because after my first competition season, I went on like a stupid, ridiculous bulk. Like it was like eating everything in sight, and I've learned a major lesson from every year that I've competed.
For sure.
So obviously in 2012, the first one was I need longer than 6 weeks to prep.
Yep.
Okay, so I need a longer prep. And on my 2014 show, after those competitions, my major lesson was I did prep for a good long time, but just don't get too fat in the off season. So to
Yep.
like put it to you, like I was on stage on my first show at like 73 kilograms.
Okay.
Like I got up to like almost 100 kilos in that
Wow.
off season. So you can imagine, like young guy testosterone's at all time high, lifting pretty much every day and just eating the world. I think that, all that combination was just that's when I built majority of the muscle mass that I have just during that period of time there.
Yeah, no,
Yeah.
I'd actually kind of relate to that in the fact that I think my first experience of like having a gaining phase, whilst the training maybe wasn't structured as well as it could have been, and I didn't have a periodized program or anything special like that, I was eating a lot and enough protein. I was training hard and I did get pretty heavy. Like I got, I think, a good 6 or 7 pounds above my peak off-season weight this year in my first gaining
Yeah.
phase, and that was like 2 years ago. So I was obviously, I had way less muscle
Yeah.
mass and a lot more fat. But I do
Yeah.
agree with you in the fact that I think younger competitors, and this is something that I'm going to touch on next, but I think some of the younger competitors out there get a little bit too het up in the fact that they should stay a little bit leaner and do the whole lean gain process and be very regimented with the amount of scale weight they gain per week, and they almost get a little bit too stressed and het up on it, and they almost forget to have the bit where they try just train hard and eat, and you grow quite naturally as a result of that. So, in your opinion, what's the current situation that you're seeing with sort of teens and juniors with regards to competing? Are you seeing people maybe compete too early? And how, if a listener is like a young person and they want to compete, how long would you recommend people investing in their physique prior to doing that first show?
Yeah, for sure. I think, to begin with that question is like, if you are going to do a show, you've got to ask yourself why you want to do that show and what do you want to get out of it. So like for me personally, I want to be the best and I want to go on a show and I want to win that thing. Like I'm not going to train, bust my ass, diet for however long to come second. Like that's not going to happen. So that's me personally. But I think for them, they should ask themselves, do they just want to get on stage just to have the experience and I guess just have fun, or do they want to go up there and really try and go for the win and be the best that they can be. And you gotta realize as well, between those ages of like probably a lot of young guys starting to get in the gym probably around 16 or so, would you agree? In
Yeah,
the
I'd
age of
agree.
16?
Yeah, maybe a
Yeah,
bit younger now.
between that kind of 15, 16 to 20 years old age gap, you're gonna make the best gains of your life
Yeah, sure.
in that time period. In my opinion anyway.
Yeah.
So if you're always trying to be super lean, you could potentially leave some gains on the table for, how much you're able to actually progress. So I think some advice that I've given to other young guys as well is I think the age difference might be a little bit different in the UK. So over here in Australia, teenage is 19 and under,
Okay.
and juniors is 21 and under. You guys got 23 and under,
Yeah, we
correct?
go 23 under. Yeah, that's it.
Cool. I've told a lot of guys to compete in their last year eligible for their age category.
Yeah, no, I agree.
So,
Yep.
whether that's a teenager, you're 19 years old on stage. So potentially, most of the other guys should be 19 on stage, but then you've got the 18-year-olds, 17, 16-year-olds, which just don't have that level of muscularity from not having as many years of training,
Yep.
especially on that. At that young age, 1 year, and like I said before, between my 2 year kind of 1 year off season, that's when I made really drastic improvements in my physique. At that age, a year you can put on a lot of muscle mass when you're that young.
For sure.
So every year that you have before you actually jump on stage is just going to benefit you, and you're just going to do even better. But in terms of, like, minimum training time or whatever to get on stage, I think probably at that age, like, I'd say, like, at least most guys are probably going to have at least 2 years of training before they jump up as a teen.
Absolutely.
I think, as young guys, we all want to do well and prove ourselves and everything. So I think, 2, 3 years at least before you want to jump up, that's probably okay.
No, I agree. I think that whole idea of competing in the last year that you're eligible is a really good plan because, as frustrating as it is, the age category and the way that that's set out is favoring anyone that's at the top end of it naturally because they've probably got the most training years behind them. Being a younger competitor, you've all probably trained for a similar amount of time. There's probably not so many people that have just got into it. And you've got to put yourself in if you're like us, like me and you, we're both very similar in the fact that I totally agree with you. I only compete because, well, my main reason for competing is because I want to win the thing. Like I'm competitive and I want to win the thing. And that's if that's your main goal at the end of it, then you've got to consider putting yourself in the most optimal situation to do that. So yeah, I would definitely agree that competing in the last year is probably the most beneficial idea. And I think again, unfortunately, with younger people, they sort of want to compete because it's fashionable or because that's kind of the reason they get into lifting. So they might now see like on Instagram, they'll see like a bodybuilder like us, or they might see maybe a higher profile bodybuilder like an IFBB pro, and they'll get into the gym as a factor of that. And then I think me and you obviously got into the gym because our sport that we were playing, it required us to be more physically fit. So we got into the gym quite naturally, if you get what I mean. I think that's kind of a better way to get into things rather than being, oh, I see an IFBB pro, I want to look like him, let's get into the gym and then do a bodybuilding show within like a year. They forget the whole investment and the whole actually just enjoying training. And similarly with females as well, like they seem to get into it because they want to be a bikini competitor and they forget to actually build the muscle and they diet and they don't enjoy the dieting and then they actually fall out of love with the gym, which is shocking. But yeah, okay, so I think,
Oh, just
yeah, add to it,
sorry.
go for it.
Just to add to that, with the whole, getting into it for the right reasons. Like, if you told me that, I wasn't allowed to do any more shows anymore, I'd still train. You know what I mean? So I
Sure, of
think,
course, yeah.
you got to get into it because you love to train, not because you just want to compete. So, I think if you don't have that foundation of just, the love of training and just like working hard, you're not going to go very far if you're only doing it just to get on stage. You got to actually love the process and actually love training.
You'll soon find out how hard it is when you're dieting and like extremely lean. I remember seeing a video of you that I thought was probably one of the best videos that I've ever seen on YouTube with regards to contest prep and training. You put up like a leg workout really close to your show, and it just showed the raw intensity that you have to be in when you're struggling like fuck to get through a session. And it displayed it so well because I've had so many sessions exactly like that where you just have to grind out every single rep and push yourself through the entire session. Even just turning up sometimes is like the hardest thing, but you get into it and you do eventually enjoy sessions. So yeah, I thought I was properly good just to give you a shout out there.
Oh, thank you very much.
So people love like talking numbers, Zach. So you competed obviously the first time in 2012 and you competed recently in 2016. So just give us some, I guess, some comparisons if you can remember them off the top of your head. What was your stage weight like in 2012? And then what was your stage weight like recently in 2016 in terms of numbers? And then we can obviously have an idea as to how much muscle you've realistically laid down across that time period.
So 2012, my first shows, this is just a rough guess. I'm pretty sure I was on stage around the 73 to 74 kilogram
Okay,
mark.
sure.
Where I started that prep, it probably would have been like, I actually used to stay, I was actually, in pretty decent nick before that show, but I was probably about 80, 82 kilogram there. But what you got to remember is my conditioning at that 74 kilograms,
Wasn't good.
like I was, probably like five kilos at least off
Okay, yeah.
where I could have been.
Okay.
And in comparison to last year, my off season weight was around 90 kilograms,
Sure.
and I competed at my very last show at about 77.5, 78 kilograms. Okay,
Okay,
so it
yeah.
was roughly 12, 13 kilo weight loss there. But my conditioning for that show was, I would say, almost perfect.
Yeah,
Almost,
no, I agree.
almost. So not quite there 100%, but I was pretty happy, and it was the leanest I've ever been in my life. So
Yeah,
yeah.
sure, exactly. So, also, what did, in comparison as well, what did, because obviously 2014 you got really, really lean as well, for a junior. You were a junior at that point, yeah? Correct?
Now I was a
2014?
teenager
Oh,
still.
you're a teen. Okay, awesome. That's
Teenage,
even better. So, in
yeah.
2014, what was your stage weight, and then in comparison, what was your what was the gain in terms of stage weight gain across the 2014 to 2016?
That's funny because it's probably only about a kilogram difference.
Really?
So I think,
Wow. Look way more
yeah.
than
Yeah. So that's just
that.
conditioning as well. That's
Yeah.
conditioning too. Like obviously I was very lean in 2014, but I still think that I was next level above that last year,
Okay.
in 2016 compared to that. So yeah, only weight difference was, about a
That's
kilogram different.
mental. That's mental. That's like, because I obviously follow you really, really closely, so I've seen all the pictures, the comparisons, etc. And like some of the comparisons, if people go away, look at your Instagram, scroll through, you'll see like that kilogram difference makes, and obviously the better conditioning combined with that makes a huge difference in terms of the images, and that just, I guess, makes me excited as a result of having a year off and being like, I'm coming back down now, so like I'm already probably like 5 or 6 pounds heavier than I was at my peak off season last year, and I already feel leaner than I was then. So it
Yeah,
is
good.
crazy how like little bit of time off and investment, like it makes a big difference. And then obviously even if the scale weight on stage is pretty similar or a little bit above, it will make a big difference. So
Yeah,
that's
definitely.
awesome. In terms of your off seasons, Zach, so you had an off season in 20, it must have been 2015. What did you use, and obviously what are you using now as your primary motivators to keep you on track with training and nutrition? Because I find a lot of people seem to be only motivated by fat loss and only motivated by a show date. Now, what's keeping you motivated in these gaining phases?
Yeah, it does get a little bit hard sometimes post show, because what you
Yeah.
generally see is you start to get less and less conditioned,
Mm-hmm.
and it still takes, I think, like a good 3 to 4 months post show if you're properly lean
Yeah.
to actually get any type of strength and power back, really.
I agree.
So those following couple months can be tough because you're looking worse and you're still not
That's
as
wrong.
strong as you once were.
Yeah.
So, what is it now? I competed in, last show was like October last year, and it's January, March now. I only just started, like, over the last couple of weeks to actually feel strong again.
Yeah.
So, that can affect you a little bit. But I think, towards the mid to back end of your off season, I think something that helps me a lot is just loving to train, really.
Yeah.
Just loving to train, and like I said before, like if you told me that I couldn't compete anymore, I'd still train just as hard.
Yeah.
But a couple, maybe a couple good little things with the off season is setting some sort of strength goal.
Okay.
Whether that be like a 1 rep max or a for reps kind
Five
of
rep
thing.
max, yeah.
Yeah, so I think, last off season I set myself a goal of I wanted to squat 200 kilos for 10 reps. I think I managed 8 at the end, so I didn't get that one. But just setting yourself some sort of strength goal. So when you go into the gym with your, major lifts, you have something else to focus on rather than just how you look at the time. Because obviously, I look at myself now compared to when I was on stage and I'm like, oh man, I'm like 10 kilos heavier, I'm fat, blah 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 blah. When really I'm not. It's just, it's just it all in your head, and it's just, just the contrast. But yeah, I think, focusing on external goals rather than just how you look at that current point of time, could be really good.
Yeah, no, for sure. I totally agree with the whole strength goals thing and kind of taking yourself like a back seat away from thinking about how you look all the time, because unfortunately when you're prepping, the main thing that you're bothered about is stepping on the scale. Is it going down? Yeah, perfect. Am I looking better? You're constantly like you're with these two variables, and unfortunately that's where some people forget strength retention, and then they look shit anyway because they've forgotten about retaining their muscle. But
Yes.
you're obsessed with these two variables. It's quite easy to get obsessed with it, either the scale or the way you look, and then transferring into an off season with a gaining phase, you're like, what do I focus on now? And I think focusing on strength and focusing on progressing your numbers, and like if you're logging your training, your logbook becomes a very exciting tool to always beat and always progress with. And yeah, I totally agree with that. And with regards to the strength regain as well, I know exactly how you feel with that, because I think, I finished my shows at a similar time period, and it took me again until sort of probably midway through the next year to start gaining momentum again. And like we talked about this on Instagram before about how we don't see why people compete every year, because it's taken Zach like the best part of 6 7 months to start even sort of tapping into regaining some of the strength that he had, which is obviously quite demoralizing. So yeah, I think those are all really, really good points. When it comes to your training at the moment, Zach, with regards to sort of the way you set up things in terms of your structure throughout the week, have you found something that for an off season or even for a dieting phase that just works for you and that you found has been a consistent sort of setup for your off seasons and dieting phases?
What we might start with is just when I'm dieting, I guess. So last year I prepped for 24 weeks, and on like my goal was obviously to retain as much strength as possible. So that whole 24 week prep, I actually my training program looked almost identical from this day one to, competition day. And the reason why was so I could compare my numbers
Of
from
course.
day one to the show date. So that's kind of what I like to do last year. And I think, trying to hold on to that strength as much as possible is really important for your muscle retention, as long as you're not putting yourself under risk of injury.
Agreed.
Because that becomes more evident the leaner that you get, and the kind of more body fat and weight that you kind of drop.
Agreed.
But in terms of now in the off season, how I set up my programming, so basically after my first kind of season of competing, I've always been lower body dominant, especially my quads. So a lot of my off season training is just what it should be for any bodybuilder, really. It's just prioritizing your weaknesses, really. So currently I'll hit. I kind of do a 3 day on, 1 day off, 3 day on, 1 day off. So I don't actually fit into a typical 7 day a week routine. This is actually the first time I've done that. I've always liked, I want to train this on Monday, I want to train this on Tuesday, and so on. But I've been doing this probably the last 3 months, and I've been really enjoying it. So, 3 on, 1 off, and over that kind of 8 day cycle, I'm training 6 days, and only one of those 6 days I'll hit my lower body. Okay, so it's 5 upper body sessions to every 1 lower body session. And my lower body sessions are predominantly hamstrings and glutes. So the only real quad activity I'll get is squatting and maybe some lunges as well. But did you want like exact how I like set up each day, like what I train on this day, that day, that day as well? Or?
No, absolutely. I think you've explained it really, really well there. I'm interested a little bit into more specifics, not so much with the actual days, but just whether you're more of a, I guess, higher volume guy comparative to most. Give the listeners an idea as to maybe how many work sets you kind of do in a normal session, if you can think off the top of your head, and that will give people an idea as to potentially whether you're a higher volume guy, or, you know, everyone obviously has a different MRV or maximal recoverable training volume, so it's just interesting to see whether a guy with your muscle mass has sort of quite a high MRV. I'm expecting you to have that. Yeah, I kind of am.
I do typically train with quite high volume. Also, my frequency as well is quite high on my weaker body parts. So over that kind of 8-day cycle, I'll probably hit chest 3 times over that 8 days.
Wow. Okay.
I'll hit shoulders probably about 4 times.
Okay.
Over that 8 days. You know, a lot of that, when I say that, it's not, you know, something like a side lateral raise. You know what I mean? So if I'm just like throwing, you know, 5 sets of that on every other upper body day, it kind of accumulates a lot of volume over the week. But generally it's quite high volume. I'm just trying to think off the top of my head how many working sets I would do. So on my first kind of like 3-day cycle, I go upper, lower, upper.
Mm-hmm.
On my upper body day, I'd probably do, just let me have a think. Man, it's a guess, probably anywhere between 30 to 40 sets.
Yeah, no, that's quite a lot. Yeah,
that's
for sure.
That is quite a big workout though, because I would generally do, you know, 2 chest exercises, 2 shoulders, 2 back,
yeah,
1 bicep, 1 tricep. So you got like 7 different exercises, and you're doing, you know, 3 to 5 sets on every single one. You know, it builds up quite quickly.
Are you how long are your sessions usually taking for like a general upper body session?
Anyway, between 1.5 hours, 2 hours.
Yeah, no, that sounds about right.
Depends how long I'm resting between my sets as well.
Yeah.
Generally, I like to really closely track my, especially my first exercise, whether it be a bench press or a strict overhead press or something.
Okay.
Just because I'm quite numbers orientated with that. Everything else during the session, I may not track as much, go sort of by feel.
Okay, in terms of log booking, so your log book like the first couple of movements, yeah?
Yeah. Just because I really like to closely kind of log them. So, yeah, and if I'm doing some like heavy overhead presses, and I'm, you know, I could be taking anywhere between 3 to 5 minutes rest break.
Yeah.
So if you're doing 5 sets of that, that's
a long time.
20 minutes of resting.
Yeah.
But then,
yeah,
then again, you know, I don't mind because that first movement, I'm really quite numbers orientated. I want to hit certain numbers in those movements. Again, going back to that whole motivation for off season, being able to hit certain numbers.
Yeah, sure.
So that's why I really take that time with that first exercise. Everything else is a little bit shorter rest break, not as heavily tracked.
Uh-huh.
But that's generally kind of how I would set it up.
Awesome. Amazing. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. I think that when I was sort of getting into the deeper ends of my off season, and similar with clients as well, I kind of like to take the reins off some things for a little bit. So like with their accessory movements, they might be able to go by feel, or at least train hard but have an idea of where they're at, but not necessarily track everything. Same goes with like nutrition, and it's a question that I'll just shoot to you right now. I don't think I structured it, but yeah, in terms of like nutrition, do you back off the gas a little bit in terms of the way that you're tracking your macros throughout the off season, and what do you believe the benefits are in terms of competitors maybe not tracking every single macro all the time in a gaining phase and an off season? What's your nutrition like?
So this off season, I've actually taken a different approach compared to my previous two.
Okay.
Previous two, I would still almost track my macros down to the T every day. Proteins, carbs, fats.
Yeah.
Yes. Very, very rigid like that. So that was, yeah, even the opposite. But, in saying that, I would, there would be a couple meals during the week that are that wouldn't be tracked.
Have out, yep.
Yeah, just to kind of enjoy it a bit more. But yeah, thinking back on that, yeah, I was very like, and it was getting down to like, if I had 15, even less than that, like 5 grams of protein to the eat that
Yeah.
night, season, I would have it. You know what I mean? So it was very, very rigid like that. This off season, I've been a little more relaxed with
Okay.
it. Most days I'll try and hit my macros pretty bang on,
Sure.
but I've taken some days where I just hit protein and calories, and other days I'll just kind of just eat and just make sure I get maybe 4 to 5 good doses of protein in during that day. And I've been maintaining my body weight on that pretty comfortably, being able to progress strength wise in the gym.
Nice.
So I have taken the approach of being a little more relaxed. I think that came from last year's competition prep, just prepping for so long and getting leaner than I ever have before. Mentally, just it fried me.
Very food
So
focused and things like that, yeah.
yeah.
Yep.
So I think if I just could just not be as strict with myself this kind of off season, I'll be able to enjoy myself a lot more rather than really panicking if I'm under or over a certain macro or whatever. So I'm a little bit more relaxed now, which is fine.
Yeah, no, I do agree with that. In fact, I can relate to you again quite massively with the whole strict and regimented feel that people tend to sometimes drag into their off seasons. I think it's kind of a good thing because it shows that we as competitors are really driven and really dedicated to maximize every single minute, hour that we have in terms of gaining and maximizing each session. I think it's quite easy to get too relaxed and people then, stop hitting their protein intake, being stupid with meal timings so that they're going without protein for like 6, 7 hours. And I just think that they throw it by the wayside, and that's when they don't make any off-season progression, and that's really frustrating. So I think there's two sides to the argument. You've got to be regimented enough to stay somewhat on track, but at the same time, you've got to have the relaxed, off the gas feel so that when you do go into a comp prep again, you're actually feeling a bit fresh and you're like, okay, I'm actually ready to go. Like mentally, I'm a little bit more stable now. And I think that's personally coming off the gas a little bit the end of last year has made the transition into tracking everything to the gram again so much easier. And I feel like this like has been so easy so far because tracking is quite new. It's almost kind of fun again because I kind of like it, and obviously you can get bored of it really easy. One more question, sort of reverting a little bit back to training. With training intensity and obviously taking sets very close to fail, pushing hard in every session, how often do you see it that people maybe get too entwined in a program and specific numbers and their logbook and they actually forget to train hard? And how important or how high do you rate training intensity in terms of a useful tool to maximize hypertrophy?
That can be the problem with log booking everything in terms of, let's say you beat, whatever you lifted last week by 2.5, 5 kilograms. You're like, woohoo, win. But you still left like 5 or 6 reps in the
In the
tank,
tank, yeah.
and it's gonna take you what, like 3 or 4 months just to even just reach that, maximum potential threshold where you're actually struggling
Yeah.
to hit, a certain goal weight. So in terms of that, like I'm of the mind of like if you're gonna try your training, like maybe the first 1 or 2 sessions, maybe leave a rep in the tank. But by like week 3, you should be like almost at failure, and really having to grind and push yourself to hit those reps. And like I said before, with like me personally, with like log booking. I mostly just log the bigger movements like a squat, a bench press, a deadlift, an overhead press or something like that.
Sure.
So I feel like, with an exercise such as like a lat pull down or, a dumbbell side lateral raise, you can really like cheat out a whole heap of reps and kind of lie to yourself how
Yeah,
like much you're progressing.
you
But like,
can.
like with a deadlift, that's honest. Like you have to pick that off the ground to your hips. And that's that. You can't cheat there. And same with the squat when you're hitting depth and bench press, the bar hits your chest and it comes up kind of thing. So I think that one's the most importantly track. And what was it? Intensity. Intensity is gonna be everything really. Like if you're not like busting your ass in the gym, like what are you doing? You know what I mean? Like you don't see the guys that are the best kind of natural bodybuilders, like even just for an example, like Doug Miller. Have you ever seen that guy train? I'm sure you have. Like that's just stupid, crazy intensity, and that is why he's where he is today, really. So I think you have to train to your maximum intensity levels every single time you go into the gym. But with that said, there is a time to kind of step off the gas and have a little bit of an easier session and kind of use a little bit of auto regulation and kind of deload when you need to.
Yeah, and I agree with that.
Because I'll never schedule a deload into my training.
Okay,
Like it's
interesting.
always like I'm like flat stick with my training. Like I'm going as hard as I possibly can every session. And if I need a deload, I will, but if I'm progressing, I'm happy and I'm training well, I'm not going to. And in terms of like a deload, that just might be, I wake up one morning, I know I got to squat that day and I'm feeling pretty shitty. I just won't train. I just won't train. And that's why I really like the way I've set up my programming at the moment is because I don't have to train on a specific day of the week. So if I need to take that one extra rest day to kind of recover, I can and I don't feel bad for missing my Wednesday chest session or whatever. So I think, and also with the deloads, I kind of like program them in for like whenever I go back home to my home or something like that. So they're not something like, every 6 weeks I'm going to have a deload here or whatever. Because I think if you're doing well and you're progressing, don't stop. I just keep going.
No, I actually really, really agree with that. I think that the deload factor is like it can ruin momentum so much. I've had times where I'll schedule deloads and I'll stick to them like a T, and I know that I'll get to the deload point and almost like, am I fatigued or am I just not sleeping well or not hydrated, not getting my meals in, or something like that? And there'll be other variables that could counterintuitively make me think I need a deload, but in reality I don't, and I can continue pushing. And there's been a few times where I have continued pushing and got like so much more progression out of that extra 2 3 weeks. And then I think you only really need to deload when you are fucked and you are like literally on your last legs, like progression is really starting to get tough and you need that week. And you actually, by then, you actually enjoy the deload because you've pushed yourself so hard that you like, oh, finally I like get to actually take a set that's not like ball busting almost to failure.
I
So
agree.
yeah, I do think that's really, really important. Obviously, when deloading and things like that, we're doing things like minimizing the risk of injury. And something that I had to ask you is, have you ever dealt with quite a, I don't know, a decent injury that set you back a fair amount, or that you've had to work around? Even if it's just like a niggle that's been there and you've had to adjust things or work around it. Have you experienced anything like that? And most importantly, have you worked around it or overcame that issue?
There's been like plenty of like little niggles here and there, but I've been really fortunate that I've never had like a major injury that has like really put me out of training.
Good man. Nice.
Most recently was probably coming out of my competition prep last year. Had a bit of hip pain,
Okay, interesting.
particularly when squatting and deadlifting. particularly when I was low bar squatting, just anything, where I would set my hips back or have some sort of hip extension. I couldn't really deadlift anything over 170 kilograms.
Okay.
So basically how I dealt with that is I just, I'm fortunate as well with, those lower body injuries is if I want to take a bit of time off not training my lower body, that's not going to ruin my physique because it's already quite developed as it is. So, that was just a matter of me of just not doing those movements that hurt it. And I think as I progressively put on body fat, it just kind of fixed itself. And that's fine. But I think
Maybe just being
the
lean.
beauty of bodybuilding. Yeah, exactly. So I think that's why that came on and practicing posing a lot and kind of flexing at the top of my quads toward my hip flexors there. I think doing that, like practicing that a lot really kind of jacked
I
up my
know,
hips a bit.
I kind of notice when you set your quads as well for poses, you kind of internally rotate your hips and then pop them back out.
Yeah.
Is that something that you did to like get engaged with your quads more out of interest?
So generally, like you see a lot of people when they pose on stage and they flex their quads, they kind of flex their quads from like halfway down, if that makes sense. So like you won't see a lot of people with like deep cuts all the way up towards their hips. So what I kind of like to think about when I'm obviously flexing my legs for like posing is kind of flex them from the top of my hips to get those cuts at the top, and then the rest of my leg will just kind of naturally flex with that. So that's kind of why I pose like that, really.
Yeah, no, sorry, I just picked up.
And just but yeah, anyway, getting back to like injuries and that, like the great thing about bodybuilding is if like you can't do something, there's always another exercise you can do. So if you can't squat because you got a bad back or whatever, there's a leg press there, extensions, curls, lunges, everything. So I think it's fantastic in a way of if you do have an injury, focus on what you can
Can
do.
do,
Don't
yeah.
focus on what you can't. Don't focus on what you can't do, because then you're just gonna do your head in. It's just gonna be mind fucking. So yeah, just focus on the things that you can do and do them well. You know what I mean? Say you got a shoulder injury, it's probably a good time to catch up on that leg development that you've been missing out on. I don't know. So just so you can always do something else. So yeah.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I think people can get quite psychologically down with injuries. I know that when I get even just a niggle, I couldn't imagine what like a full-on injury is like, but even just a niggle with me, I will get down about it for a bit, but as soon as, like you said, you accept it, acceptance is quite key, and then you're like, okay, what can I do? So can I leg press? Can I split squat? Can I leg extend, etc.? Yes, I can load the quads brilliantly. Right, let's just go ahead and do some things that I can actually do. But yeah, it's good also that you've trained for so long, done so many shows, and managed to stay, pretty much relatively injury free. And it just goes to show that, that's really, really important when it comes to building maximum muscle mass is actually just staying injury free. And you've probably had very efficient training blocks where you've gained a lot of strength, and that's a custom of staying injury free as well, which
For
I think
sure.
so many people overlook. They get like a big injury like a month into their training career, and that stunts a lot of progress.
Well, like if you see what the best natural bodybuilders in the year, they're all like over sorry, the best natural bodybuilders in the world, they're all, they're 35 to 40
It's an
years
old man's
old.
sport,
So
yeah.
exactly. So we got like 15 more years to go, so we can't break ourselves now. So, it's all about the long run. So, you gotta, there's times to really push, and then there's times to like, say, oh, that doesn't feel right. Let's stop. So, yeah.
Agreed. Cool. So when it comes to dieting, and be it off season or pre-contest, what is your general approach to things, and will you just share your thoughts on the idea of flexible dieting versus other people running meal plans, etc.? And I guess actually more primarily with this question is your approach to pre-contest. Are you a dieter that just utilizes flexible dieting, or do you start to eat very similar foods every single day and fit to more a structure? Just discuss your general approach to sort of flexible dieting and pre-contest.
So just to start with, just how I went about just setting up my food to start with.
Sure.
So I have a coach. My coach name is Nathan Wallace. He's actually the business owner of the place that I work at, Hold Your Own.
Hold your own, yeah.
So he's a natural pro bodybuilder. So he kind of looks after a lot of my prep for me, so I don't freak out and make stupid decisions. Even though, like, I know the reasoning behind why he's doing everything, but it's just super important that you have someone else look out for you.
Agreed.
But basically, just setting it up, like, I knew where my off-season macros were, so basically it was just taking a cut to them. And generally throughout competition prep, protein will stay consistent the whole entire time. It started at 240 grams a day, and that's where I ended up. And just my calorie reductions pretty much just came from carbs and fats, really. So protein was always the same. And as terms of flexible diet, yes, I did flexible diet my whole prep. The thing you got to realize is, though, is as you get lower on food, you're not going to be able to fit too much of that calorie dense goodness within, calorie dense foods into your meal plan. So probably for the first 14 weeks of my prep, I was eating fairly similar each day, but maybe dinner might be something different.
Sure.
And it was never, I never ate rubbish. I always ate, clean whatever foods. But it just gave you that option just to have something, slightly different. If you wanted some loaf ice cream, go for it. But when I got down to my lower calories, I did in fact pretty much eat the same thing every day, even
Nice.
though I would say that I would call myself a flexible dieter. But when you're on a low amount of carbohydrates, you want to eat a lot of vegetables, and you don't want to have these things like crap, yeah, into your diet, because they're just going to chew away at your calories, and you're going to be hungrier, because as you probably know yourself, towards those last couple of weeks of prep, they're hell, and you're just starving all the time. But I guess the only downfall of having that option of tracking your macros is sometimes you get really fixated on what little treat you can fit in any day, or what's something different I can have, or can I fit some ice cream or something like that into my meal plan? And at the end of the day, the answer is always going to be no, because that's not going to fill you up as much as your veggies. But I remember going to the supermarket, and I would just literally I'd be like, I need to go to the supermarket, I need to get a lettuce. But then I'd just spend half an hour just walking through the aisles, picking every single package up, being like, what are the macros on this? And just spending like half
Yeah,
an hour in there to
no,
get a friggin' lettuce.
yeah.
That could be the downside of that, of just not having just a regimented plan, just saying like, that's what you eat, no exceptions, that's it. But yeah, towards the end, it was probably like 95% of the same foods every day, because the way that I kind of set out my food was, I only ate four meals in a day. I ate my breakfast, I had a big pre-training meal, I had a big post-training meal, and then I had like a relatively small dinner, which was just like protein and veg. So the way that I set that up was like probably, most of my carbs was around my training, just so I could perform better in the gym, really.
Yeah, perfect.
But yeah, it just pretty much ended up being the same thing every day towards the end.
And yeah, I think you touched on a really good point there towards the end, is that like with your carbohydrates and situating them around your sessions, like there's nothing crazily amazing about that with regards to fat loss, but with regards to performance in your sessions, obviously that was what primarily gave you good training sessions. And obviously people react in different ways, people like different things, but I've seen for the most part a good way to structure your nutrition will be primarily basing your carbohydrates around your sessions. It just kind of makes sense, right? And a lot of people tend to forget that with flexible dieting, and they start doing the crazy things with like carb backloading and just loading all their nutrition for pre-bed because they want to make this like flex bowl and put it on Instagram. And I just get frustrated with that, because I think that you can't possibly be maximizing every gram that you're putting in by doing these stupid things. And if you're dragging your ass through a training session just to have some variety in your diet, then you're not really doing bodybuilding. You're more doing like competitive dieting. You're trying to figure out a way to figure out how you can fit in some rubbish. So yeah, I think you've got the approach like nailed, and I think a lot of people should take that away from this podcast, is that see, Zach's got incredible results, both conditioning and retaining a lot of muscle mass, and he's done that via focusing on what's going to work best for training performance, which is massively key, and obviously flexible dieting as well, which is kind of cool because a lot of people look at your physique and say, no, it's not possible with flexible dieting, which is kind of rubbish. Cool,
No,
Zach. So we're coming up to an hour, so I'll finish up with some final questions for you, really. So when you look into the future as a natural athlete, what's your main goal? So what's the top of the tree? What do you really want to do as a natural bodybuilder?
not. Be one of the best in the world, really, simply put it.
Simple.
In terms of like shows to win in that, like obviously in Australia, I don't even know if you mentioned I'm from Australia. From Australia, in Australia we do have natural bodybuilding federations, but I guess, to progress to the next level on like a world scale, I would probably have to do some shows over in America.
Sure.
There are some freaks over there. But yeah, man, like I want people to look at me in the future and be like, yeah, he's one of the best in the world for sure. But I know that's going to take probably another 15 years of training, but that's okay. I'll enjoy the journey. Yeah, that's probably like the main goal there. I just kind of want to be the best that I can possibly be within the sport.
Amazing.
Number
Cool.
one.
Good man, good man. Now you can definitely see it in your dedication, your passion, and in like all your videos that you pop or Instagram posts. It's evident to see that you just simply want to be the best, which is cool, and probably why I connected with you and followed you, is because I share similar passion. Like when I do the sport, I just want to be the best at it, and I'm not in there for the glitz or the glamour or anything else. Like I just want to be really, really good at it. Which is cool and nice to meet someone so like-minded. Also with like the natural scene, do you always see yourself being a natural athlete? Is like, have you ever had thoughts of going over to quote unquote the dark side or anything like that? Obviously from the sounds of it sounds like you want to stay natural and be the best natural bodybuilder you can be. Is that correct?
This is absolutely no question about it.
Awesome.
I have no interest in going the other way, really. Many reasons that are probably similar to yourself. And as well, just coming back to, you obviously want to be the best at this sport. And I probably can't do that if I start being enhanced, if you know what I mean.
Of course, of course. Yeah, no,
So,
that
yeah.
makes sense.
Besides that, it's never interested me. And like, I can honestly say it's like never crossed my mind to even like, should I do that kind of thing? Like, just, it's never been there. So, yeah.
And like I say, like you just prove how the or the potential to get incredibly big and very conditioned as a natural athlete. So, if you can achieve that naturally, then I think it's much more rewarding personally, to be able to say that you've stepped on stage with a physique that you've created purely by yourself and your own work ethic. And obviously, similarly, enhanced athletes will have very similar work ethics, I'm sure, to create some of their physiques. But at the same time, they can't say they did it all themselves, which I think is something quite important. But yeah, awesome, Zach. So finish off. Thank you very much for your time. And if anyone's looking to continue to follow you, I'm sure there'll be a few people that haven't maybe heard of you before that want to grab on to your socials. So give people an idea as to maybe where you're most active on social media, and also if they want to like contact you, hold your own, got a business page or anything like that they could follow. But yeah, just give where people can follow you basically, mate.
Pretty much just my Instagram. It's just Zach_Poulos.
Okay.
Also have a Facebook page, which again is just my name.
Okay.
The business I work for is called Hold Your Own, so they also have a Facebook and an Instagram page, and they also have a website. So, out of all that, if you need to get in contact with me, Instagram, Facebook's fine. I'll probably just pass you on my email address, and we can go from there.
Amazing, cool. Wicked, Zach. Well, again, thank you very much for your time. Enjoy your Friday. I believe it's Friday over there. And
Yes, it's Friday.
yeah, I'm sure that people will follow you, stay in touch. And yeah, thanks again for coming on, mate.
Cool. Thank you very much for having me on. It was awesome. Thank you.
Awesome. No worries, Zach. So yeah, listeners, thanks again for listening to us for an hour of your time. Thanks for spending it with us. And if you care to review the podcast on iTunes, that would be greatly appreciated. And if you've got any questions for either me or Zach, if you are on YouTube, that would be awesome. Just pin them in the comments below, and I'm sure either me or Zach will get back to them and give you any answers that you want to have. But yeah, thanks again for listening, guys, and see you back in episode 29.